The end of Kamsa. As per the orders of Kamsa, Akrura started the next day for Brindavan, and she is to have a darshan of Sri Krishna, the Lord Supreme. He mentally thanked Kamsa for giving him this opportunity, though with a vile intention of meeting the Lord and obtaining his grace. While travelling, his mind was full with the thoughts of the Lord, and at one time he doubted whether the Lord would condemn him as a cruel fellow, being an accomplice of Kamsa, or the omniscient Lord, who knows everything, would take him to be a true devotee. He concluded that everything was being arranged by Providence for his own good, that he was really blessed, and that all the merits of his previous births were paving the way for him to have the darshan of the Lord. Akrura reached the outskirts of Brindavan. He saw the herds of cows and calves wading their way home with jubilant cries. The cowherd boys were merrily following them from behind. He saw the footprints of Sri Krishna and Balarama. He was overwhelmed with joy. He got down from the cart and entered Vraja on foot. Not very far, he saw the fulfillment of his ambition. The enchanting figures of Sri Krishna and Balarama became visible to him. They were beautifully dressed and were wearing precious ornaments and fragrant garlands. He could see their smiling faces. He fell down prostrate at their feet with meek submission and extreme devotion, his eyes overflowing with tears of joy. Sri Krishna and Balarama lifted him up and embraced him. They took him home, gave him a good bath, new clothes, and a nice dinner. When all the elders were seated in peace, Sri Krishna inquired of Akrura about his errand. Akrura narrated the whole story from the visit of Devarshi Narada to the bogus invitation for Dhanuryaga by Kamsa. Sri Krishna laughed at this in himself and informed all the elders that they must respond to the invitation of the king for the Dhanuryaga. They had to get ready with presents for the king in the shape of milk, curds, ghee and money. He asked them to secure the same in plenty. Accordingly, with great many presents, Nanda and his followers started for the great festival at Mathura. Sri Krishna sat in the cart driven by Akrura. The whole party moved on and halted on the banks of the lake Kalindi, made sacred by Sri Krishna. Sri Krishna and others got down, quenched their thirst, and returned to the carts. Then Akrura, with their permission, went to the lake, had a bath, and was chanting Vedic hymns in praise of the Lord. As he dipped in the water, he could see Sri Krishna and Balarama in the water. He was astonished. Many times he dipped, and every time he could see their enchanting figures. He doubted his own vision, stood up and looked at the carts. The two were comfortably seated in the carts. Once again, he dipped and found them in the water. He saluted the Lord for giving him this divine darshan, praised him to his heart's content, and considered himself the most happy person. Slowly, he returned to the cart. Sri Krishna casually asked him, "The lake is so near. It took so long a time for you to return. Was there anything extraordinary in the water?" Akrura replied, "You are the Lord of the universe. You are all wonderful. All wonders are in you. Could there be any wonder apart from you? There, here, everywhere, it is all you alone. What more can I say?" They reached Mathura. Sri Krishna got down from the cart. Akrura requested him to visit his abode when his present errand was accomplished. The Lord accepted the invitation. Sri Krishna started on foot, admiring the magnificent palaces, the lofty buildings, the wide roads, the green parks, the high fort walls, the elephants, horses, and the soldiers, the richness and beauty of the whole city and its landscape. As they went along the road, men and women, having heard that Sri Krishna, the blue boy of Brindavan, the darling of the gopis, had arrived, began to look at him from all vantage positions, and they feasted on his beauty. A group of worshipmen were carrying a load of washed royal clothes. Sri Krishna stopped the chief of them and asked for some fine clothes to wear. The washerman remonstrated and said that the cowherd boys had gone mad to ask for the king's dress. At once, Sri Krishna gave him a blow on the head and he fell down dead. Out of fear, the other washermen unloaded their bundles. Sri Krishna took some fine dress for himself and his brother and gave some to his followers. As they were moving forward, a weaver decorated them with colored silks. A flower merchant put on fine garlands round their necks. A servant maid of deformed body, short and crooked, was carrying a cup of sandal paste for the king. On seeing the brothers, she stopped and offered the cup to the divine brothers. Sri Krishna received the same with pleasure, and in return, he, by his grace, relieved her of her deformity, and she shone forth like a beautiful angel. As they went forward, many of the citizens offered many presents, fruits and flowers to the brothers, which they received with grace. By and by, they reached the mandir, where the bow of Mahadeva was kept and worshipped. They entered the mandir and paid due respects to the bow. Sri Krishna then took the bow with one hand, strained it and drew the string tight. The bow broke into two pieces with a thundering noise. The gods got afraid and began to attack the brothers. The two brothers took up the two broken pieces of the bow and killed the whole lot of gods. It was getting late in the evening. Balarama and Sri Krishna returned to the camp where Nanda and the others were waiting to take rest for the night. By daybreak, the whole city was busy. Large crowds had gathered at the palace for the Dhanuryaga. Kamsa took up a prominent seat in the exhibition grounds. Nanda and the other cowherds paid their respects to Kamsa and occupied the dignified seats allotted to them. There was great tumult and noise of drums, trumpets, band and other ceremonial instruments filling the air. Sri Krishna and Balarama heard the great sounds and repaired to the exhibition grounds. At the palace gates, the great royal elephant Kuvalaya Pida was standing, and on seeing the brothers, the mahout drove the elephant against them. Sri Krishna caught hold of its tail and dragged it round and round like a rat and killed it. With the huge tusks plucked from the elephant in hand, Sri Krishna and Balarama entered the exhibition ground, killing everybody that dared to attack them. They were met by the two court wrestlers, whom they destroyed in a few minutes. The audience was stunned by their valor, including Kamsa. Sri Krishna looked at the confounded state of Kamsa even as he was sitting in his own throne. Immediately, he jumped at him like a lion and dragged him down to the ground. Kamsa lay stretched on the ground and life was found to have gone out already. Seeing the fate of Kamsa, his friends began to attack Sri Krishna and Balarama. Balarama single-handed destroyed them all. The gods were much pleased with the end of Kamsa and his friends, and they showered a rain of flowers on Sri Krishna and Balarama. Sri Krishna immediately got Vasudeva and Devaki, along with Ugrasena, father of Kamsa, released from prison, had their chains of bondage removed and prostrated to them. Both brothers begged their pardon for having kept quiet so long when they were being harassed by the cruel Kamsa. Ugrasena was placed on the throne of Mathura. Sri Krishna, knowing that the time for parting had come, expressed great gratitude to Nanda for all the affection with which he had brought up him and his brother. He gave him permission to return to Vrindavan. Vasudeva then performed the Upanayana for Sri Krishna and Balarama amidst great pomp. Immediately, the brothers reached Avantipura and adopted sage Sandipani of Kasi as their guru and learnt all the Vedas and Shastras and every other branch of knowledge. Being the incarnations of the Supreme, they completed their education in less than 3 months. As Guru Dakshina, they brought back the dead son of their Guru, was immensely pleased with them for the gift, as such a gift was not presented as Guru Dakshina by any pupil to a Guru at any time. Taking leave of their Guru, they returned to Mathura. Having reached Mathura, Sri Krishna dispatched Uddhava, a great devotee of his, to Vrindavan to console Nanda from the pains of his separation from Sri Krishna, which was unavoidable. He requested Nanda to bear the same with patience. Uddhava accordingly visited Vrindavan, met Nanda and conveyed to him the message of Sri Krishna and remained there for some months. As per the instructions of Sri Krishna, Uddhava met the several Vraja gopis also and explained to them the special message sent by Sri Krishna to them, that in order to make them concentrate their minds on him, Sri Krishna, he had gone out of their sight. By this, he expected that their devotion for him would increase and help their meditation. Further, their lives would become full or paripurna, and so he requested them not to be depressed by their physical separation. The gopis realized the significance of his message and were fully satisfied. Further, they wished him well in the further adventures that awaited him. Sri Krishna requested Akrura, who was very much like a father to him, to visit Hastinapura. The Pandavas, his aunt Kunti's sons, were reported to be living in a very helpless condition, being ill-treated by Dhritarashtra, the blind king. He requested Dhritarashtra through Akrura to follow the path of righteousness and treat them better. Accordingly, Akrura went to Hastinapura, met all the relations and remained there for some time. One day, when Akrura was alone with Vidura, Kunti approached him and narrated to him the harm that was being meted out to her and her children. They were made to suffer the bite of snakes. Bhima was tied hand and foot and thrown into the Ganges. He was given poison with his food. While they were asleep, they were attacked with weapons. Further, Kunti said, "The blind king's son, Duryodhana, is merciless in his actions. Do not Sri Krishna and Balarama think of getting our share of the kingdom and make us live happily?" Akrura consoled her with hope and courage. When Dhritarashtra was in a peaceful mood, Akrura addressed him thus, "Your brother Pandu is no more. You are the head of the kingdom. Now, if you reign righteously, you will be having fame and prosperity. Otherwise, evil will be your lot. You must treat your sons and the Pandavas as equals. Why should you have greater attachment with anyone? What will your wife and children bring you in the long run? When one is being born, another is dying. Sons share the fortune of the father, but never feel grateful or think of repaying. Therefore, do not succumb to ill fame. Though you are physically blind, intellectually you are not. Therefore, give the Pandavas their share of the kingdom and live a glorious life." Dhritarashtra heard all his words calmly, accepted the truth implied in them and said, "Let everything proceed as per the dispensation of the Lord, who is born to protect the world in the form of Sri Krishna." Akrura grasped the significance of those words, took leave of them all and returned to Mathura. He reported his endeavors and the results thereof to Sri Krishna and Balarama.